Okay.
At the outset, I thank Dr. Ashutosh, Dr. Pallavi, and Dr. Vinay Tosh for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts, views, concepts on sexual dysfunction and making this lockdown very meaningful. Vakt acha zarur aata hai. Men do get erections. Par kambakt vakt pe nahi aata. पल पल तरसते थे जिस पल के लिए वो पल भी आया पर कुछ पल के लिए सोचा उस पल को रोक लूं और पल के लिए पर वो पल न रुका एक और पल के लिए दिस इज अ स्टेट ऑफ अफेयर्स विद अस द टॉपिक व्हिच आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे इज डिसलिपिडेमिया एंड इरेक्टाइल डिसफंक्शन ऑफ कोर्स वी ऑल नो फैट्स आर यू नो दे आर लव्ड बाय ऑल दे आर द एसेंशियल पार्ट्स ऑफ आवर डाइट एंड दे help us in making hormones, making cell membranes, vitamins, and so many things, gives you taste, etc. But there is another aspect of this particular nutrient. So let's see in this next 20-25 minutes, I'm going to give you some nuggets of wisdom as to when you get patients with dyslipidemia and they do complain of some sexual dysfunction, particularly males, how do you tackle them? I pray to God. And I thank my teachers, Dr. O.P. Kapoor, Dr. Prakash Kothari, and Dr. Sashank Joshi, and I beseech them to bless me. Mitro, it's lockdown. Look at his hands are down. And he's saying, stay at home. So I'm following it. I'm staying at home. We all are following him. We are all staying at home. But I want to say you can raise your hands by looking down. So look down also in you. In a committed monogamous relationship, my dear friends, COVID-19 is not a sexually transmitted disease. We haven't found COVID-19 viruses in the semen or in the vaginal fluids. Across the globe, 40% of people are men are dissatisfied with their sex life. 50% of couples in Japan are living a sexless life. There have been increased incidences of divorce across the globe, more so in India. One out of five men who seek or who get divorces due to sexual dysfunctions. Erectile dysfunction affects 50% of male population above the age of 40. And when I Googled, I found Viagra had 196 million web pages and aspirin had only 53 million web pages. If you do not want ED, so if you don't want ED, you should know what is ED. The etiology of ED is it could be psychogenic, vasculogenic, neurogenic, hormonogenic, drug-induced, and even genetic today. So I define as ED is psycho-vasculo-neuro-hormono-iatrogenic. Why I say because genetic, they have found a SIM1 gene loci in the genome, and over 32,000 patients with ED were examined and they found these genes in them. We are living in an era where there is so much of pollution. The air pollution itself causes endothelial cell damage and can give rise to erectile dysfunctions. Not only in children we find the affections, we also find in older cohort also. Erectile dysfunction and lipid disorders is a huge subject. Epidemiological studies show that elevated serum cholesterol and reduced HDL are associated with increased risk of erectile dysfunction. Dyslipidemia is a risk factor for erectile dysfunction. It impairs the erectogenic mechanisms by affecting the endothelial and smooth muscle cells of the penis. Masters and Johnson beautifully describe the male sexual response, which begins with the desire, leads to excitement, and then ejaculation and resolution. This is a beautiful diagram to understand the whole physiology of erections. The vascular endothelial cell, which produces endothelial nitric oxide synthetase. Friends, this is a very important enzyme. Now, this diffuses and potentiates the nitric oxide, which is the main chemical signaling molecule. I call nitric oxide as the currency of the cell. it enters into the smooth muscle cell of the corpora cavernosa and converts guanosine triphosphate into cyclic guanosine monophosphate with the help of an enzyme called guanylyl cyclase. This cyclic GMP, through various mechanisms, relaxes the corpora cavernosa smooth muscle and allows the blood to flow in the penis. But sadly, this cyclic GMP hydrolyzes into 5-GMP with the help of an enzyme called phosphodiesterase 5. So if at all we expect a good erection, or if we plan to give treatment, what we must understand as medical students, that there has to be enough endothelial nitric oxide synthesis, for which the endothelium, the vascular endothelium, needs to be normal. Hence, erectile dysfunction is an endothelial dysfunction. Secondly, we need nitric oxide. We need guanylate cyclase activators and stimulators. We need cyclic GMP to be there in more bioavailable form. And we need some things to block this PDE5, which we have today in the form of sildenafil, tadalafil, vardenafil, and eudenafil. So penis has now become the barometer of endothelial health. I call erectile dysfunction as nothing less than penile attack. And this barometer of endothelial health, and we find this issue in mainly four type of patients whom we see day in and out. They are diabetics, hypertensive, obesity, and dyslipidemic patients. What happens is, due to inflammatory diseases, there are functional and structural changes. Structural changes happen because of atherosclerosis, and functional changes happen because of the endothelial damage and does not relax very well. So there is impaired vasodilatation, impaired smooth trabecular muscle relaxation, early changes in the penis we see is difficulty in getting erections. What happens when there are structural changes? There's spasms, there is this artery size diminish, smooth muscle atrophies and fibrosis. All these ultimately lead to arterial insufficiencies in the most of the organs, particularly in the penis, where we see reduced penile inflow and excessive penile outflow. Mm-hmm. So this is what happens actually. And we see comorbidities in patients with erectile dysfunction, all these four. Dyslipidemia is manifested by raised cholesterol, bad LDL lipoprotein cholesterol, and the triglyceride concentrations. Atherogenic dyslipidemia is high TG, low HDL, high, small, and dense. The difference between dyslipidemia and hyperlipidemia is, in dyslipidemia, it's any abnormality in the lipid levels of the body is identified as dyslipidemia. Whereas hyperlipidemia is a form of dyslipidemia where all the types of lipids are extremely abnormally elevated. In dyslipidemia, the lipid levels can either be increased or decreased, but in hyperlipidemia, there is always an increase in the lipid concentrations. We have now enough evidence to prove that low testosterone is associated with obesity, metabolic problems, and it contributes to the sexual dysfunction and the cardiovascular disease. In a beautiful article written by my friend Dheeraj Kapoor, dyslipidemia is associated with testosterone, estradiol, and androgen receptor CAG repeat polymorphism in diabetics, and we see diabetics day in and out. For desire, we need sex hormones, that is testosterone. It's a libido hormone. And all diabetics are testosterone deficients. We also understand that there is androgen deficiency or hypogonadism in all patients who have metabolic syndrome. Androgens are very important. They maintain the penile tissue structure and functions. They maintain the vascular endothelial structures. They maintain the tunica albugina structural integrity and connective tissue matrix of the fibroelastic and of fibroelastic properties. Androgens regulate differentiation of the precursor cells. Androgen maintain the penile, cavernosal, and dorsal nerve structure and functions. So androgens, especially testosterone, is very, very important in maintaining a good erectile function. When Masters and Johnson, I told you already. So what happens in dyslipidemia? It affects the desire and erections because there is low testosterone and the erections are not there because the size of the penile vasculature reduces. 70% of all men with erectile dysfunction have associated cardiovascular diseases. If we look at the current status of the cardiovascular disease, India has got the highest mortality of cardiovascular disease, the highest. In fact, it is coming 10 years earlier than the other countries. So much is the extent of cardiovascular disease. There are Indian studies. And there is 50% of mortality in the non-communicable disease is due to cardiovascular disease. And we all know that erectile dysfunction is the earliest marker of myocardial ischemia. So look at this, that if we know this patient has got ED as soon as possible, we can predict that these patients could be having future coronary events or carotid blocks. So the main reason is atherosclerosis. Montessori beautifully explains that the penile artery diameter is 1 to 2 millimeters, coronary artery diameter is 3 to 4 millimeters, internal carotid is 5 to 7 and femoral is 6 to 8. When atherosclerosis sets in and the 50% of any vessel gets blocked, say if penile artery is 50% blocked, it will produce symptoms of erectile dysfunction. But this, and atherosclerosis is generalized across the body. So the same amount of atherosclerosis doesn't occlude 50% of the coronary artery or internal carotid or femoral artery. But atherosclerosis is progressive. Sooner or later, even the coronary arteries might get 50% block, and these patients will get stable, unstable angina. If internal carotid may get 50% block, patients can get stroke or claudication if the femoral artery. So if we detect, the clinical acumen of our physician has to be such that if we have a patient who has a family history of metabolic syndrome, he comes at the age of 30, do ask him the history of sexual functions. Just ask him a simple question, that do you have problems in making love? Because it is proven that erectile dysfunction is the first sign of cardiovascular disease, and the onset of coronary artery disease is about after 2 to 3 years of the onset of erectile dysfunction. So you have that much time to, you know, counsel the patient, reduce his hyperglycemia, dyslipidemia, counsel him to quit smoking, alcohol, give him all lifestyle measures, put him on strong medications, and reduce or retard the onset of critical events like myocardial infarction or stroke in his life. So that is why asking a history of sexual dysfunctions, particularly in males, erectile dysfunction as early as possible is important. Because if you ask him after he's got angina or a stroke or anything, you have missed the boat. He's already got ED. So if you want him to have a good quality of sex life or good quality of life per se, please ask your patients that do you have problems in making love as soon as 25 to 30 years of life. Because as we look at the events when cardiovascular disease progresses from endothelial dysfunction to clinical events, we found these patients having erectile dysfunction throughout. So before the onset of any coronary event, any cardiovascular disease event, we need to ask our patients about this. And that's where our clinical judgment lies. In fact, all the risk factors of cardiovascular disease are also the risk factors of erectile dysfunction. So ED can be a prognostic marker. Enough studies to prove that there has been a relationship between erectile dysfunction and subclinical cardiovascular disease. What more we want? It is a proof beyond doubt. Now, how do we manage erectile dysfunction? All patients who come to me, they just ask one question. Doctor, I want a hard penis. They have children. They are having sex somehow or the other. But the goal is satisfaction and erection hardness. So we have an erection hardness score. Severe 1 to 10, moderate 11 to 21, mild 22 to 25. Grade 3 and grade 4 don't need, in fact, any treatment. They just need counseling. Grade 1 and grade 2 people need treatment, need evaluations. We do the neck circumference, which is very simple test to identify that this patient is having ED. If the neck circumference in men is more than 37 centimeters, surely he is having erectile dysfunction. If it is less than 97, it's definitely good. Then I work for Bombay Police. I look at the dropping belt signs. And this is how I come to know that this patient is surely having erectile dysfunctions. First, we rule out what are psychogenic causes. The only way to rule out is ask your patient's history about morning erections. If in the last 8 to 10 days, even once he got up with a hard-on, he does not need PDE5 inhibitors or medications. He is normal. He has got psychogenic or situational ED. So please, please ask this simple question that do you have morning erections? This will rule out all psychogenic causes. We advise our patients on smoking, diet, exercise, blood pressure to be controlled less than 130/80. Lipids, yes, very important. Total cholesterol less than 150. LDL should be less as possible. It should be around 60 or even 50, it is still better. HDL has to be more than 40. HbA1c to be less than 7. Eye, feet, and feet to be examined every time when your patients come to your clinic. Don't go by the guidelines. Examine the retina, the feet, and the oral hygiene every time when they come to you. Put them on guardian drugs like aspirin, ACE inhibitors, and statins. Work them up for heart and give them. Other tests we do are serum testosterone, free total, sex hormone binding globulin, thyroid, FSH, LH prolactin, sonography of the scrotum, Doppler study, serum PSA, and free and total, and digital rectal examinations. We also do endothelial dysfunction studies with flow mediated dilatation, carotid thickness, coronary artery calcification score, ABI, TBI, and pulse wave velocity. We have this beautiful gadget called Regiscan. I don't use it, but is a fantastic equipment to rule out psychogenic and organic ED. What we do is we tie electrodes at the tip and the base of the penis, and this is connected to this gadget called nocturnal penile tumescence rigidity detector. And the patient is made to sleep in the night. In deep REM sleep, every normal person gets 3 to 4 erections, which last for 20-25 minutes. And these could be easily plotted. And these are the plottings of a patient who had psychogenic ED. And these are the plottings of patients who had severe organic ED. I go to the post office and I get free of cost a roller of stamp, which I give it to my patients. They tie it snugly at the night when they sleep. In the morning, if the stamp, if it breaks, he's normal. I don't charge them anything for this. We have duplex ultrasound, peak systolic velocity we see, end diastolic resistance index we see. We can also diagnose Peyronie's index, Peyronie's disease, and venous leak. So many things we can diagnose. Now we have handheld Dopplers also available, which you can connect it with your mobile and look it at the bedside. You don't have to send these patients outside. But yes, when you want to do a detailed study, you need papaverine injections, Cavajet injections, and to see if everything is all right. But you can initially, just with handheld Doppler, you can easily diagnose these things. The treatments are oral drugs and counseling is the first line. The second line is injection of papaverine and other drugs with counseling. If that fails, vacuum therapy and counseling. Otherwise, intraurethral prostaglandins and counseling. If all these fail, we send these patients for implant surgery or anastomosis surgery. But counseling forms the mainstay treatment of erectile dysfunctions. We have all PDE5 inhibitors, sildenafil, tadalafil, eudenafil, and vardenafil. They all have different onset of actions. They all have common side effects like flushing, facial flushing, headache, nasal congestion, dizziness, dyspepsia, visual disturbances, priapism. The common side effect with sildenafil is headache. The common side effect with tadalafil is backache. So please tell your patients they may get this. Nothing to worry. They are all reversible. But there are 40% patients who don't respond to these PDE5 inhibitors. So can we do something to convert these non-responders into responders? And why they fail? Because they fail because we have not given. If you have a male who's 60, 70 years old, and if you give him 25 mg of sildenafil, if he's got no contraindications, like he's not on nitrates or anything, or doesn't have any hypotensive issues or any physical abnormality or structural abnormality in the penis or leukemias or anything, you can give him easily 100 mg of sildenafil. Ask him to take at least hour and a half or one hour prior to the dinner if he's planning to have sex after dinner. So after taking the tablet, one and a half hours prior to dinner, please ask him not to watch Aastha Channel or News Today or Times Now or Arnab Goswami or think of Radha or anybody. Just he needs to stimulate himself. He needs to think erotic. And once he has thought erotic for the next one and a half hours, he should have a very light meal. Because post heavy meals, most of the body's blood gets collected on the stomach and intestine to digest the food, which is a must. And in doing so, his private parts are deprived of the optimum blood, which he needs to get a desired erection. And once he's had this, once he had a light meal, he should continue thinking erotic. And on the day one of taking the medication like sildenafil 100 mg, he should not have sex. He can sleep with the partner, do foreplay and do everything what except penetrative sex on day one and day two and day three. These 3 days, he should feel the difference and experience the change in him. These feeling the differences and experiencing the change in him will give him confidence, which he lacks. So this is the time you need to spend with your patients when you're prescribing PDE5 inhibitors. I find doctors don't prescribe, and these patients go and take from the chemist without even knowing what it is. And they come and they say it doesn't reply. So PDE5 inhibitors fail because they were not taken in the recommended dose on full stomach without any sexual stimulation and just before the sexual activity. The best for every diabetic is low dose of PDE5 inhibitors like tadalafil on a long-term basis. Very, very safe. Enough studies to prove tadalafil improves the endothelial dysfunction. It improves prostatic enlargement. It also is a fantastic medications for reducing lower urinary tract symptoms. So you, and also gives you very good erection, which can last a little longer than what sildenafil can give you. So chronic therapy with PDE5 inhibitors is a valid choice. If you want to give him a symptomatic treatment, of course, PDE5 inhibitors are the best choice. But if you want to give him a cure for this problem, you need to think of something better than pharmacotherapy. Or along with pharmacotherapy, you need to give him something which is called as regenerative therapy, which is in the form of phytonutraceuticals, which we have today. Beautiful study we did was buried penis syndrome. Most of these patients, they have suprapubic fat. Their penis is almost buried, and they when they have to pass urine, they have to remove their pants completely, and it's a very, very embarrassing thing. So what we did was, we gave these patients 1 gram of metformin, sesame seed oil to be applied on the shaft of the penis, and 5% arginine gel. Enough studies to prove that these are all beautiful medications which can do their effect. In 24 weeks, we found we could see these patients having at least 2 inches of penis, which is visible, which was not seen in these patients. And this paper was published in the IDF in Dubai, Management of Buried Penis Syndrome, the DJ SAM, that is Deepak Jumani, sesame seed, arginine, metformin approach. A fantastic, simple way to approach. Now, in erectile dysfunction due to dyslipidemia, what is the role of lipid-lowering drugs? These are the very important things which we need to know. Of course, PDE5 inhibitors are drugs, but do we have to add statins? Do we have to give niacin? Yes, studies prove that niacin alone can improve the erectile function in patients suffering from moderate to severe ED and dyslipidemia. When cells are beautifully studied, that if we gave only sildenafil to patients with dyslipidemia without knowing that he had dyslipidemia, or he did not know about it, or he did not think of addressing it because it was slightly raised, what he found was these patients did not get good erections. So when he added along with sildenafil atorvastatin, 8 out of 9 men improved in erections and got adequate penetration during sexual intercourse. So the lesson number one is, along with this statin, if you add PDE5 inhibitors, it works very well. This is another group of patients studied by Herman. They combined sildenafil and atorvastatin of 80 mg and they found fantastic results. Oral sildenafil of 50 mg didn't work, but it combined with 80 mg of atorvastatin improved their sexual functions like anything. Then Gokhaya beautifully studied, and he said that just with oral sildenafil, he had a huge number of studies, and he found that oral sildenafil and atorvastatin showed improved function, which was really documented with IIEF standards. Now, in patients who have been operated for a radical prostatectomy for prostate cancer, the dictum is you have to give only sildenafil. The studies show that sildenafil 50 mg for 6 months. But Hong et al. Added sildenafil and atorvastatin of 10 mg for 6 months. And penetrations improved, erections improved. So this class of patients don't just need PDE5 inhibitors. You have to add little bit of atorvastatin or statins. The new drug, polymorphism with PCSK9, the name also is too good. A beautiful study called Spredia. They took pre-diabetics and diabetics adults and two cohorts of healthy children, pre-pubertal and adolescents. So there are three class of patients. One, diabetics, some of them were pre-diabetic, some of them were diabetic, and the other two classes of children. And they tried this drug and they studied the genetic composition of these patients. And they found the adults were about 1188 and they were of 45 to 75 years of age. And children pre-pubertal were only 1983, 1,983, 830 adolescent, that means up to 16 years. So they tried all these things and they wanted to study whether there is some polymorphism which exists in these patients, which naturally reduces the LDL and does not get them erectile dysfunctions. So these are the characteristics. Now in these patients, they found GG carriers, their LDL was more. And even these carriers, they had LDL, which was more. So they found that in lipoprotein metabolism, children under the 6 years of age, they had LDL, which was high. And also in the adolescents, they found that this was. But in this group of patients who had T allele, in the adolescents, they had reduced LDL. So they got an indication that this polymorphism of R46Cl has some role to play in patients who could get. And they studied patients, adult patients for erectile dysfunction. And they found that patients who had GG and TT allele, they had either less or no ED, or they had very mild ED, and either they had no ED at all. So they concluded that carriers of less frequent T allele of R460L variant of the PCKS9 gene, randomly selected from, this was 48,000 patients they examined, and it was a national study, had reduced intima media thickness and lower prevalence of erectile dysfunction without differences in the LDL cholesterol. So conversely, children and adolescents with this allele had a significant reduced LDL cholesterol and ApoB concentration. So it was a beautiful study, and they could now predict that these patients will not get erectile dysfunction. Now, one question which many doctors ask me is that if we give statins to our patient to reduce LDL, their cholesterol also decreases, of course, which is the need of the time. But along with that, the testosterone levels also decrease. And if testosterone decreases, their desire decreases, their erections don't happen properly. Now, what do we do in this situation? So beautiful study done. Is lower LDL cholesterol associated with lower androgen and erectile functions? These are all the participants. So what they concluded, that lower LDL cholesterol levels per se were significantly associated with lower free testosterone and free androgen index after various adjustment in the general populations. Moreover, both high and low LDL will have lowering of cholesterol and erectile dysfunction, that is no doubt about it. So what American Heart Association and American College of Cardiology Foundation said, that you cannot compromise with the life of the patients. You have to continue giving statins. And then these patients, because of the statins, they have got a hypogonadism. You can supplement testosterone for a while. So that is the recommendation by AHA and AACF. So the answer is that testosterone, which reduces on taking of statins, can be replaced without getting any, there will be no side effects of the testosterone hormone in patients who have been taking testosterone replacement because of statin intake. Let me give you a new perspective of this. This is a thing which we know. So we need nitric oxide, okay, to start the whole erectogenic mechanism. Or to be still ahead, we need endothelial nitric oxide synthetase to be present in the endothelium, for which we need to have endothelium. Now, there have been beautiful newer concepts. We know that endothelial-derived nitric oxide is an antithrombotic molecule. It is also an anti-atherosclerotic molecule. So newer concepts of, they found a protein, PGC1-alpha, which dictates the endothelial function regulation through ENOS expression. So if they gave this protein, they found that the blood circulation improved in the penile vasculatures. Amazingly, they found that it improved every improvement in vasculation, blood flow everywhere in the body, including the penis. And even patients who had hypertensive, their pressures also came down and the restoration of the blood flow was seen. So this is a new thing which has come. PGC1 alpha is a protein which is helps in regulation of endothelial nitric. Now, we all know about random ROS, which we consider to be harmful. But no, there are endogenous ROS, which are nothing but NADPH oxidase enzyme. We call it NOX. Now, this NOX family, NOX4 family isomers, also are very helpful in producing good endothelium. They rejuvenate the endothelium. And enough studies to prove that endothelial NOX4 oxidase enhances vasodilatation, reduces blood pressure. It is a very important component of endothelium to make the endothelium normal. NOX2 and NOX4 mediate proliferative response in endothelial cells. So this is a very beautiful thing which is now studied, and soon we'll have certain drugs. Another, we have lipoprotein lipase. We all are aware of what role lipoprotein plays. Now we have lipoprotein lipase activators, which is going to revolutionize the treatment of dyslipidemia. So for vascular disease to happen, there has to be endothelial dysfunction. And dyslipidemia is one of the commonest thing which can cause endothelial dysfunctions. Now let me give you a deeper perspective. We know that endothelial dysfunction leads to erectile dysfunction, which is the earliest marker of myocardial ischemia. So, and people are dying of heart disease more than anybody else in any other country. So what do we do? Now, this recent study says that nutraceuticals have a potential in boosting type 1 interferon response in usually in these sort of atmospheres, including influenza and coronaviruses. So we need to increase our diet, which has got immune enhancing properties, including the arginine. So there was a beautiful study, immune enhancing diets for stress patients with special emphasis on arginine, analysis of the analysis. And they proved, along with antioxidants, which is going to be anti-inflammatory, glutamine, which is a precursor of L-arginine and citrulline, also is beneficial. L-arginine is amazingly helpful because it is a nitric oxide donor. It is an essential amino acid. It does not even help in producing nitric oxide, but in protein synthesis, cell division, urea cycle, creatine, muscle, it builds your muscle also. The youngsters who are taking testosterone for building their muscles or taking hormones, they should be advised to take arginine, which is equally and in fact more better and safer. It stimulates hormone release. Deficiencies of hormone will definitely reduce your immunity per se. So L-arginine has got multiple benefits, which is very well studied, and we all know it is available to us. It is so economical, so safe. The discoverer of L-arginine producing nitric oxide got a Nobel Prize, Dr. Louis Ignaro and all. So the key to having good sexual health in patients who are dyslipidemic, we need to understand that today diabetes is reversal. DPP study shows with just diet and exercise, patients for 15 years have been euglycemic. Metformin is a beautiful drug which can reduce weight, and it is also improving the endo. We have to give something to our diabetes. So metformin, which is a very good drug, it improves endothelial functions and erectile dysfunction. It can be given as an adjunct. SGLT2 inhibitor, this is a beautiful paper which we published in IDF in Busan, that it is, it reduces weight, it reduces hyperglycemia, hypertension, dyslipidemia. So another, because of the property of the drug itself, we can reduce the endothelial dysfunction by giving to our diabetics SGLT2 inhibitors and metformin and lifestyle measures. you don't have to give him any PDE5 inhibitors or give him any pepavirenz injections or send him for penile implants. This is the way you can save your patients from taking drugs which give them unrealistic erections. ESC guidelines also said, Dean Ornish proved in patients that with just intensive lifestyle, vegetarian food, aerobic exercise, stress management, smoking cessation, all the coronary artery blocks, which were around 95 to 98%, they got dissolved. He's proven, published in New England Journal of Medicine and JAMA. Even loneliness can be genes, whatever problems our genes have, only 20% are dictating of whatever happens to us are dictated by genes. 80% of what happens to us is dictated by our lifestyle. I'm a live example of this. So it is nothing but lifestyle which can even make over your genetic things. So epigenetics and telomeres, even patients with cancer, prostate, we have seen that 5-year study improved just with lifestyle medications. When we look at the risk factors, whatever risk factors are there, it is usually the behavioral issues which we all humans have. Either we are smokers, either we take alcohol, or we get stressed, or we eat anything rubbish, we eat a wrong diet. So mostly the problems are behavioral. Prabhakaran beautifully studied and he found out that in spite of improvement in smokers, improvement in obesity, improvement in physical activity, they are doing exercises, improving in lipids also, they have found that improvement by taking statins and all that, improving in the blood pressure, improvement in the diabetes. Everywhere, every factor, risk factor is reduced. But still, why patients are getting more coronary artery disease in our country or across the globe? The only thing, look at this center block. It has got no green pixel and it is because of the healthy diet, which we all are lacking. So enough evidence to prove that because of less healthy diet which we take, we are all getting these issues. And beautiful study, recent, 21st April 2020, that there have been association of lifestyle, erectile dysfunction and health. This is a huge study and they found out that anybody who went to the doctor to seek help, they were benefited and they were advised lifestyle. So smoking, age, alcohol, all these things were reduced and the overall prevalence of ED, which was very high, they found that just diagnosing and even talking to the patients was enough and they got good relief. Now let's think deeper. We all know that dyslipidemia is very common, hypertension is common, diabetes is common, and the only thing which is we are lacking is healthy diet. So Cleveland Clinic published their research that if you have a patient who has got coronary artery disease, you send him for stenting. Okay, he gets his stent done. Now, we have seen patients who have already got stent, their stents get re-stenosed. So they have to again go for another procedure. Say, in case if the patient is diabetic, we do CABG, CABGM. And these surgeries also have to be redone later in the life. Look at Manmohan Singh. So these procedures are helpful, but they don't halt the disease. They don't reverse the disease. Cleveland Clinic proves that nutritional intervention in their studies not only halted the disease, but even reversed the existing disease. And they showed it with the perfusion studies, restoration of myocardial, just with lifestyle measures. Such a huge plaque without stenting has been improved with just lifestyle measures. So nutritional intervention is the key to help every patient of dyslipidemia, even if you do not want to give him statins or even if he is averse to statin, if he does not take it well, this is the first advice we all should make it a rule to give them. Mediterranean and diet has been very helpful. Ezetimibe along with nutraceuticals have worked wonders in these patients of this. This is original research published 5 years back. Male sexual functions have now been studied and they have found that nutraceuticals or herbal supplements have. So hence Thomas Edison beautifully said in 1902, the doctor of the future will no longer treat the human beings with drugs, but rather cure and prevent disease with nutrition. Friends, please understand, you are what you eat. I think we all fall sick only for two reasons. One, what we put in our body, and second, what we do with our body. So you are what you eat and what you drink. So please, please have a halt on this thing. Advise your children not to go for it. Lovingly, emphatically tell them the advertisements across the television, they are making them mad. But yes, talk to them emphatically and they will listen to you. Your stomach is not a waste paper basket. Jainism beautifully says, kam khao, gam khao, nam jao. What a beautiful thing to say. But you can't change the tide, but you can learn to swim in spite of you being obese or whatever it is. How do you burn your fat? Do you have anything to burn if you have such a big paunch? Yes. My take-home message is to all of you is the onus of sexual health, whatever may be the problem, lies with we physicians. Even our own health, even our patients' health. We need to ask our patients. Then during this corona, we all know we need to wash our hands. This is not new. Our bhatjis and pandits, everybody, when we sit at the puja, they make us wash hands 100 times. So it is an old pratha. Why don't we follow it? This is a picture of a patient who had coronavirus on his hand. And if he 1 second washing, 2 second washing, 6 second washing, 6 seconds with soap, 15 seconds with soap, and 30, look at the complete disappearance with 30 seconds of soap. Try and keep social distancing, physical distancing. I won't call it social. Social distancing is something I don't understand why they call it, because we are more social today. In fact, this webinar is also social. We are not distancing ourselves, but we are coming together, more coming together. It's physical distancing which is required. Take a detailed history. Make lifestyle your religion. If you want immunity, if you want a passport to immunity, make lifestyle as your religion. You may be Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, anything, but make lifestyle as your religion. Diet, exercise, sleep, medications, avoid smoking, stress reduction, psychosocial attachment, supplements. It's very important. We have all the PDE5 inhibitors, but there are 40% non-responders and they do nothing for the desire. We have seen patients of dyslipidemia taking sildenafil or tadalafil. There is no improvement. So what is the point in just giving them that? And we have testosterone. We can't give testosterone to younger patients because of vasospermia. We cannot give it to elder patients because of heart failure. So what do? We are in a fix. Do we have something to give? There is a therapeutic gap because desire is the first thing which is responsible by, which is the forte of testosterone. So we can't give testosterone because we don't need to make younger patients vasospermic infertile for their whole life. We can't give patients heart failure. We can't give them enlargement of prostates or prostate cancers. So the best of all today for every dyslipidemic patient is L-arginine and fenugreek. Fenugreek is nothing but methi. L-arginine, we know, is an essential amino acid, natural amino acids. So all metabolic diseases can be reversed today, even dyslipidemia. We need to avoid smoking. We need to work out. I was 104 kilos, but I'm 64 kilos today. It's purely by diet and walk, nothing else, and stretching ourselves. So it's very, very important for us to work out. Do you like this figure? Or do you like what you are going to get because of this? No. You will get depressed. Depression is another thing which is going to make your symptoms worsen. So the key to having good thing is, please remember, life is nothing but a sexually transmitted gift with 100% more. We are not going to live forever, but we have choices to make and we have wisdom. So we must make right choices. We are all not James Bond. We cannot kill our patients by giving them PDE5 inhibitors all the time. But we should be having license to skill. We should use our skills, clinical acumen of diagnosing, detecting as early as possible the problem so that we can nip it at the budding stage. Tell your patients to have realistic expectations. They have by mistake taken PDE5 inhibitors and that goes into their mind that is the type of erection I should be getting, otherwise I am not a man. The agony of impotence is going to be there throughout. It was there even 100 years back. Leo Tolstoy mentioned about it. But you are a sexual human being. Accept yourself as you are. Every human being is a sexual human being. Try to be intelligent, erotically, how to arouse yourself. You can learn it. use different positions. Patients who are fat, they can have sex by changing the position. Try any position which suits you and your partner. Because sex today is not for reproduction after the age of 40, 45. It's not for recreation. It's for maintaining your relationship, having a good connect, making your partners feel wanted. And that's the whole thing. Friends, please understand, wrinkles don't hurt. This is all proven. So erectile dysfunction is the commonest male sexual dysfunction. It's psycho, vasculo, neuro, hormono, iatro, and genetic in nature. ED is nothing but endothelial dysfunction. Penis is the barometer of endothelial health. Lipotoxicity, ectopic fat distribution, inflammation, and lifestyle factor damages the endothelium, which leads to erectile dysfunction. ED is the earliest marker of cardiovascular disease. Dyslipidemia, obesity, reduced sex hormones. Lifestyle measures, statins, PDE5 inhibitors can reduce endothelial dysfunctions. But to be fit as a fiddle, one must tone his middle. Erectile dysfunction, friends, hence we have got so many things to give to you. It's not anything but a erectile dysfunction. And if so, your sex will never have any expiry date. Thank you all for your love.